Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to the house of the Lord to another Sunday worship service. The Lord be with you. I'm pretty sure some of you are very familiar with wearing wristbands with the words, with the alphabets WWJD, which represent what would Jesus do, yeah? I read about another colorful pins with different letters. It says P, B, P, very long, G, I, N, F, W, M, P. I'll break it down for you. So if anybody asks what those letters stood for, the explanation was given. P, B, P, please be patient. G, I, N, God is not. F, W, M, Y, finish with me yet. So together it reads, please be patient. God is not finished with me yet. All right, now Apostle Peter could have worn these pins without embarrassment. In Psalms 138, verse 8, it says, the Lord will perfect that which concerns me. It's the old equivalent of Philippians 1, chapter 1, verse 6. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? Both verses should encourage us when you and I have messed up and disappointed our Lord. A victorious Christian life is a series of new beginnings. Each time Peter stumbled, Jesus forgave him, and Peter got up and made a new beginning. Likewise, all of us have received the gift of forgiveness. As we look to the cross, may we all find a humble heart to turn our lives around, seeking God's boundless love, enduring mercies, and abundant grace. Lord Jesus, we know we are precious in your sight as we are reminded of your saving grace. Thank you, Lord, for pouring your love and life out for us so that we can be called heirs of God. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, we welcome you in our presence. Over to Mabel for our opening hymn. lack of purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Collect of the day. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than either we desire or deserve. Pour down upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those things which we are not worthy to ask. But through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. A time for confession. In Acts 2:21, everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Come then, let us confess our sins to the one who is faithful to forgive. Come then, let us adore the one who is mighty to save. Merciful and gracious God, our hearts cry out for you to make us whole again. We have sinned against you. We have been jealous, possessive, ambivalent, and impulsive. We have not heeded your word. Help us to glorify you in all times and in all places as our souls thirst for your living waters. Quench our needs and satisfy our love, that we may come back to you and be sent forth to fill the world with your mercy and grace. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, who is at work with us. Amen.
May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by His Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us now put our hearts and our minds together, and let us commit our children and also young people to our Lord. Let us pray together. Almighty God, your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Help our children and young people to keep their eyes fixed on you and fill them with understanding and confidence. Strengthen their faith and help them to live according to your will and to grow into Christ-like maturity. In name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Okay, come back, come back. Actually, how many of us do this every day? When we wake up in the morning, the first thing we say, "Thank you, Lord. I have another day." And then when we go to bed, you know, after a heavy, like people like us are, we work so tired mentally, and when we put our head on our pillow, thank you, Lord, we can sleep. So how many of us do that every day? You know, give thanks to God when we wake up, that we have a chance to wake up and give thanks to God that He can give us rest at the end of the day when we retire. So let us ponder upon this with this song, right?
Stretch up, I will bless your name.
Thank you, Lord.
Beautiful Lord, wonderful Savior, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hand, crafted into your perfect plan. You gently into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life true. Thank you.
It's the right time now that if we want to say corporately or individually, we want to tell the Lord, Lord, I give you my life. Lord, take it, mold it, use it. Fill it. Fill my life, oh God. Help me, Lord, to listen to your call. To be sensitive to your guide. Lord, lead us, oh God. Lead me, oh God. And Lord, we plead, Lord, that you will walk beside. Just walk beside me, oh God. Lord, I offer up my life to you, Father. This is the best time to tell the Lord ourselves. Lord, we want to give our lives to you, Father. Bless it, Lord. Because you are the Lord of our salvation. the grace of God has reached for me. He pulled me from the raging sea, and I am safe on the solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love. My death is saved, and my hope is hidden in the Lord. He vows each promise of His word. When the winter fades, I know spring will come. The Lord is my salvation. In times of waiting, times of need, when I know loss, when I am weak, I know His grace will renew these days. The Lord is my when I reach my final day, He will not leave me in the grave, but I will rise, He will call me home. The Lord is thank you.
Lord, we thank you, Lord, for all you have done in our lives. We thank you, Lord, that you took our darkness and gave us light. Lord, you took our sin and you took our shame. You took our sickness and you healed all our pain. For all this, we thank you, Lord. And you call us unto your presence, guiding us by your Holy Spirit. Lord, teach us, Lord, to live all of our lives through your children, through your eyes. Lord, this morning we want to commit our children to the Lord continually as they grow up in these last days. The evil in the world today is at its peak, and the target is the younger generation. A lot of children join the bandwagon of sin as they grow into teenagers and young adults. We as parents and caregivers must recognize that we are not capable of changing our children by our own power. We need you, Lord. We need the divine intervention of God in the life of our children. And the only way we can get God's attention is to pray and declare the word of God over our children. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you give them guidance and wisdom, that you help them to make wise decisions and lead them on the right path, aligning their choices with your divine plan. We pray for protection over our children, that you shield them from physical, emotional, and spiritual harm, and surround them with his loving presence. Lord, in their darkest moment, Lord, we ask God that you touch their lives. Give them hope. Give them hope and grant them strong faith that they'll be able to grow spiritually, that they can develop a loving relationship with you. Lord, we also speak shalom over the land of Malaysia. We ask that you bless the rulers, the Agong, the Prime Minister, and all the cabinet ministers, that they will rule with godly wisdom, and there will be harmony, and they are committed to steer the nation forward. We speak that there will be welfare over the nation, over every city, every town, over every family, every community and neighborhood. We ask that you will bring peace and reconciliation over all communities who are broken and disenfranchised. Lord, we also pray for the community of Wan Razak and Razak City Residences. God, help our church to reach out to the community around us. Make us a light in the darkness. Give us courage to share your love and the good news about Jesus. May our actions draw people to you and help them feel welcome in our church family. Lord, in Matthew 8:17, Jesus, you took all my infirmities and you bore my sickness. We come before you today, our brothers and sisters who are in need of your healing hand. We commit James He, Aaron George, Freddie Hsu. Lord, we seek your grace. Hold their heart within yours and renew their mind, body, and soul. Grant them the strength to move forward on the path you have laid out for them. Guide them towards better health. Lord, we know in times of waiting, in times of need, when we know loss, and we know when we are weak, we know your grace will renew each and every day. You are our salvation, Lord. Heavenly Father, let our faith be grounded in the unshakable message of Christ. Let us leave the former things and tune our spiritual ears and be attentive to the voice of the Good Shepherd. It is said in the Bible, when He returns, everything on earth will be burned away, but only two things will remain: the Word of God and the people of God. Lord, grant us discernment. Grant us discernment on the choices we make every day. Give us discernment on our priorities that we take every day, that it will be according to your divine plan. Lord, we ask, O God, Lord, that you continue to guide us in these last days. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Together, let us pray for St. Gabriel's Church. God, our gracious Heavenly Father, may you pour your Holy Spirit upon our hearts and bless the mission and ministry of St. Gabriel's. Assist us to faithfully and sincerely love one another, care for the poor and helpless, and witness to your saving love to all. Give us grace to be the servant of others, as Jesus was a servant of all. We ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We will now have the Bible reading. David Hsu will be reading from 2 Samuel chapter 19.
Second Samuel chapter 19 verses 24 to 30. Mephibosheth, Saul's grandson, also went down to meet the king. He had not taken care of his feet or trimmed his moustache or washed his clothes from the day the king left until the day he returned safely. When he came from Jerusalem to meet the king asked him, "Why didn't you go with me, Mephibosheth?" He said, "My lord, the king, since I, your servant, am lame," I said, "I will have my donkey saddled and will ride on it, so I can go with the king. But Ziba, my servant, betrayed me, and he has slandered your servant to my lord, the king. My lord, the king, is like an angel of God. So do whatever you wish. All my grandfather's descendants deserved nothing but death from my lord the king. But you gave your servant a place among those who eat at your table. So what right do I have to make any more appeals to the king?" The king said to him, "Why say more? I order you and Ziba to divide the land." Mephibosheth said to the king, "Let him take everything, now that my lord the king has returned home safely." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, David. Now we'll have the message taken up by Larry Wong.
Last week, we heard the story of three men: David, King David, who asked his officials to search for any surviving descendant of the late King Saul so that he could show this descendant kindness. And then the second man we came across was Ziba, who was the manager over King Saul's property. And he told David that there was indeed a descendant of Saul, and his name was, this descendant of Saul was the son of Jonathan. Jonathan, we know, was the crown prince during the reign of Saul. And Saul had wanted to kill off David because David was a threat to his son, Jonathan, becoming the next king. But Jonathan, he helped David to escape from Saul. And David and Jonathan became very close friends, and they made promises to one another. Jonathan said, "I will help you escape from my father so that you will not die." And David said, "I will show kindness to you and your family when God makes me king eventually after Saul." All that happened about 15 to 20 years previously. And then Saul and Jonathan, they were killed in battle against the Philistines. But after all those years, when David had come to the throne, he would not forget that sacred vow and that sacred covenant that he had made to Jonathan. And so he asked for a search to be made concerning the surviving relative of the house of Saul. And so we come to this third person in our story, Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan. He was a cripple, lame in both feet. When he was 5 years old, his nurse or his nanny dropped him as they were fleeing from the Philistines. And all these years, he grew up lame in both feet, and he was found staying in somebody else's house. He didn't even have his own house. And that tells us that he was a poor person. He called himself a dead dog, a man of no means, a helpless man, a powerless, useless, worthless man because of his disability. And then he was brought before David, the king. And David said to him, I will show you the kindness of God because of a covenant that I made with your father. And the first thing that David did was to order Ziba to give back to Mephibosheth all the land, the property that belonged to Saul and to Jonathan. And next, he told Ziba, you are now Mephibosheth's servant. You and all your sons and all your servants. Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. That tells us he was a very influential official. You and all your sons and servants will farm the land, and all the crops that are harvested will belong to Mephibosheth. And so that lame man, that poor man, instantly became a sort of agricultural tycoon. And his third act of kindness towards this son of Jonathan was to promote him to become like a prince, giving him the privilege to sit at his royal dining table in the palace. And so we can assume that the king and Mephibosheth, they shared a very close bond of friendship with one another. And this story of David and Mephibosheth is also our story. We are spiritual cripples. We are disabled by sin. We live our lives with the wrath of God hanging over us. That's what the Apostle Paul tells us in Ephesians 2, the first 7 verses. Once you were spiritually dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, you followed the evil ways of the world. You obeyed the ruler of the spiritual powers in the unseen world, the Spirit who now controls the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. Actually, all of us used to live that way. We live according to our natural desires, doing whatever suited the wishes of our own bodies and minds. By our very nature, we were destined to suffer God's wrath, just like everyone else. But God's mercy is so abundant and his love for us is so great that while we were spiritually dead in our disobedience, he made us alive in Christ. It is by God's grace that you have been saved. And in our union with Christ Jesus, he raised us up with him to sit with him and rule with him in the heavenly realms. He did this to demonstrate for all time the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. And this is the kindness of God, not the kindness of men. The extraordinary, extravagant kindness lavished upon us, just as it came upon Mephibosheth. And then we read in 1 Corinthians 1:9, God is faithful through whom you were called into koinonia with his son Jesus Christ. We were called into koinonia. And this word describes our relationship with the Lord Jesus. Koinonia, it cannot be fully described in a single English word, because it encompasses a lot of concepts. It means fellowship, relationship, coming together, having concern and care for one another. That's koinonia. It also means sharing. What I have, I share with you. What I possess, it is now common property. That's koinonia. It also means friendship, the sharing of our personal thoughts, our feelings, our hopes, our dreams. It also means partnership, being a co-worker, a co-heir, a co-earner, a owner of property, working together to achieve a common outcome. That, all those are included in that one word, koinonia. This is a story of our full redemption. Full redemption. We are not just forgiven. We are not just free from the wrath of God. Much more than that, we are friends with our King Jesus. Bonded to Him in a close relationship, in a close fellowship and partnership. And that was the bond between David and Mephibosheth. Every day as they dined together at a royal dining table, they had koinonia. That's the first part of our story, which we heard last week. Incidentally, I heard that last Sunday in DOMC, they had the same message on David and Mephibosheth. But I don't know whether they continue with part two. And this morning, we shall continue part two. Let's pray. Dear Father, we ask that you will help us this morning to appreciate more fully your mercies, your kindness, and your goodness which you have poured into our hearts. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. From 2 Samuel chapter 9, last week, we go on to chapter 19 in our text this morning. And there are 10 chapters between those two. A lot had happened in those intervening 10 chapters. David, who had been extremely kind to this one man, this lame man, this cripple, became terribly cruel to another man. He slept with his wife, and he had this man killed. And God said to him, because of what you had done, I would bring a lot of trouble into your family life. And one big trouble that came into his life was in the form of his ambitious son, Absalom, the third son. Absalom wanted to push aside all his other brothers, to compete with them and come out and on top to become the next king. And so he left Jerusalem. He went away to another town, the town of Hebron. He gathered together a lot of loyal supporters, which included political leaders, religious leaders, military leaders. He was going to fight and overthrow his father, seize the throne for himself. This was a Hebron move. We have heard of the Sheraton move. This is a Hebron move. And so he started this rebellion, and the rebellion gathered momentum, and David was in serious danger. He got all his supporters together, his loyal soldiers and officials, and he started to get out of Jerusalem as quickly as he could. Absalom's army was formidable, very strong. He was about to march into the city, and his men would start killing off all the opposition. So David and his loyal followers, they had to go across the river Jordan to escape to a safe place and then go into self-exile. And as his group was leaving Jerusalem, we read in 2 Samuel 16, verses 1 to 4. When David had gone a little beyond the summit of the Mount of Olives, Ziba, now we come to Ziba again, the servant of Mephibosheth was waiting there for him. He had two donkeys loaded with 200 loaves of bread, 100 clusters of raisins, 100 bunches of summer fruit, and a wineskin full of wine. David asked Ziba, what are these for? And Ziba said, the donkeys are for the king's people to ride on. The bread and the summer fruits are for the young men to eat. The wine is for those who become exhausted in the wilderness. And David asked him, and where is Mephibosheth, Saul's grandson? Ziba said, oh, he stayed back in Jerusalem. He said, today I will get back the kingdom of my grandfather Saul. And David then told Ziba, in that case, I give you everything Mephibosheth owns. And Ziba responded, I bow before you, may I always be pleasing to you, my lord the king. And so with one word of command, all that belonged to Mephibosheth was instantly transferred to Ziba. That was Ziba's story. His story was that Mephibosheth had repaid the king's kindness by stabbing him in the back, by backing Absalom's rebellion. In chapters 17 and 18, the next two chapters, we read about a fighting between David's men and Absalom's soldiers. 20,000 people died in that civil war. In the end, Absalom was also killed and the rebellion was crushed. And so David could now return from his exile back to his palace in Jerusalem. 2 Samuel 19:15-18. So the king started back to Jerusalem, and when he arrived at the Jordan River, the people of Judah came to Gilgal to meet him, to escort him across the river. The people of Judah, that is his own tribe. 1,000 other men from the tribe of Benjamin were with him. The tribe of Benjamin is the tribe of Saul, the rival tribe, the opposing tribe. And they also came to escort the king, including Ziba, the chief servant of the house of Saul, and Ziba's 15 sons and 20 servants. I don't know why the scriptures keep mentioning he has 15 sons and 20 servants. To show him he's a pretty powerful man. They rushed down to the Jordan to meet the king, to bring the king's household across the river, helping him in every way they could. And so everybody wanted to be in the good books of the king. Everybody loves a winner, and David was a winner. So they fell over one another in their rush to welcome him. And then we come to our text. 2 Samuel 19:24. Now Mephibosheth, Saul's grandson, also came down from Jerusalem to meet the king. He had not cared for his feet. He didn't trim his beard or mustache. He has not washed his clothes since the day the king left for his exile. When they were face to face, the king asked the inevitable question, why didn't you come with me, Mephibosheth? Verse 25. Why didn't you come with me? Well, actually, David had already been given the answer by Ziba. Mephibosheth wanted to regain power. But David wanted to hear Mephibosheth's own lips. You know, if you read the scriptures, many times God asks questions. It's not that he doesn't know the answer. Adam, where are you? Cain, where's your brother, Abel? He doesn't ask questions because he doesn't know the answer. He wants to hear it from our own lips. And so Mephibosheth replied, verse 26, my lord the king, my servant Ziba deceived me. I told him, saddle my donkey so that I can go with the king. For as you know, I am crippled. But Ziba has slandered me by saying that I refuse to come. And so David hears another version of the story. Mephibosheth said, I didn't betray you, O king. It was Ziba who betrayed me. And so according to Mephibosheth, Ziba, the servant, the influential guy, told an outright lie. And so that was David confused. Who was lying? Ziba? Mephibosheth? But everyone around the king could see that Mephibosheth was a very untidy person. His beard was long, his legs were dirty, the clothes that he had on his back had not been washed for many days. He hasn't taken a shower all the days from the time the king left for exile until the day he returned. So he was really stinking. Why didn't he take care of his personal hygiene? In those days, if you are in deep sorrow, the deepest depths of sorrow, this is what you do. You don't feel like eating. You don't feel like bathing. You don't care anymore about cleaning your body or dressing up to look nice in front of people. You are in mourning. You are sick to the core. And that was the heart of Mephibosheth. He was so sick, grieving so deeply inside him when he saw how cruel Absalom had been to this kind king. Verses 27 to 28. But I know that my Lord the King is like an angel of God. So do what you think is best. Verse 28. All my relatives and I could expect only death from you, my Lord. But instead you have honored me by allowing me to eat at your own table. What further right do I have that I should cry out and make my appeal to the king? It was the customary practice, the accepted practice in those days, that a king would kill off all the descendants of the previous king. And so Mephibosheth said, my relatives and I, we expect you to kill us off so that we don't become a threat to your throne. But you spared my life. You exalted me to be a royal prince, your adopted son, at a royal table. I look upon you, King David, as the angel of God, the messenger sent from God, come into my life and shower me with this astonishing kindness. Verse 28, what further right do I have to appeal to the king? What further right do I have to ask you to clear my name? You know, sometimes we are very insistent on our rights. Very insistent on our rights. Mephibosheth could have pleaded with David, earnestly saying to him, oh king, you know, Ziba has spoken blatant lies about me, dragged my reputation into the mud. I demand justice. I demand vindication. I demand the right to clear my name. He didn't say all that. He didn't even think like that. What did he say to David? I submit totally to your judgment. Do what you think is best. If you say Ziba is right and I am wrong, so be it. You know, it takes a man who is so overwhelmed by the kindness and goodness of God to give up insisting on his rights. Jesus did not insist on his rights. 1 Peter 2:23, when they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. Mephibosheth just entrusted his whole destiny into the hands of King David. You be the judge. You do what is best. Verse 29, David said, you have said enough. Silence, Mephibosheth. I've decided you and Ziba will divide the land between yourselves equally. You know, to David, it didn't matter very much. He didn't care very much anyway. Whether it was Ziba who betrayed Mephibosheth, whether it was Mephibosheth who betrayed him. He himself had been betrayed by his own son. And now that the rebellion had been crushed, he had a huge task ahead of him to unite his divided people. And so he settled the argument very quickly, just divide the property 50-50, you know, case closed. I'll just move on, you know. So the king thought he had the last word in that matter. But it was Mephibosheth who ended the story, and he had the last word. Verse 30. Mephibosheth said to the king, oh, let him take all of it. I am content just to have my lord the king return to his palace in safety and in peace. That's how the story ended. What can we learn from this passage of scriptures? This story tells us about the posture of our hearts, the true condition of our hearts. There is a posture of self-centeredness, and there is a posture of God-centeredness. What sort of heart did Ziba have? Well, we can see that he actually showed very good and helpful service to his king and to the king's supporters. He brought the donkeys for them to ride on. He brought food and drink for them to feed on as they made their escape from Absalom's army. So in the eyes of everyone who was in David's group, this guy, his actions are very noble and honorable. But then his heart was black and wicked and deceiving, manipulating to benefit himself. He told an outright lie. Oh king, Mephibosheth is not coming with you into exile. He stayed back in Jerusalem to follow Absalom. You know why? Because he said, today I will get back the kingdom of my grandfather Saul. And when you think about it, that is absurd. Rubbish. I mean, do you really think that Absalom, having started the rebellion and then kicked out the king, King David, gained the throne, all the power in Jerusalem, and then go down on his knees before Mephibosheth and say, oh, Mephibosheth, today I have restored the kingdom of Saul and Jonathan. The throne is now all yours. I humbly hand it over to you. That's truly bizarre, I mean. But that's what Ziba said. Mephibosheth is going to get his kingdom back. That's why he's not coming with you. Nonsense. You know, we can serve like Ziba outwardly in a wonderful way, honorable way, and in the eyes of people, they say, what a faithful servant of God he is. Look at the way he serves in ministry. What a great Christian wife and great Christian mother she is. But beneath the noble exterior, we must guard against underlying ulterior motives. Some people serve well in order to get something in return. They want people to praise them. They want to look good before people. They want people to know how spiritual they are. They serve in an eye to the gallery. It's called showy spirituality. And we become a spiritual show-off. The heart can be very deceitful. I know of a man from a church in Singapore, church of 6,000 strong members. He was the music pastor. Before becoming music pastor, he was a cell group leader. By profession, he's a judge in a law court. When someone is sick, he will go and visit them. And he does it without drawing attention to himself. He just slips in the room, prays for them, and then slips out. He won't go around telling people or WhatsApp people what he had done. Quiet, humble service. I know about this because my sister was in the cell group. And I once heard him preach a sermon on brokenness. To be broken means to have no more ego left. This man, he walked his talk. He was a man of deep humility. He was not a spiritual show-off. And that's the first posture of our heart, the egocentric heart, the heart that is centered on self-gain. And then there is a second posture, the God-centered heart, the theocentric heart. And let's consider Mephibosheth's heart. This lame cripple felt very deeply the anguish in David's heart. David's pain was his pain. David's sorrow was his sorrow. As David grieved, so he grieved. As David mourned, so he mourned. His heart was broken. He didn't want to do anything except to sit around and wait, longing and yearning and praying that no harm would come to his king, that he would return in safety to his palace. And so when it finally happened, he was so utterly relieved There was nothing more he wanted, nothing that could satisfy him anymore. That's why he said, I am content just to have my lord the king return to his palace in safety and in peace. And he said to the king, oh, let Ziba take all of it. If Ziba is so hard up to get his hands on my property, my farm, my field, my animals, my crops, my barns, let him have it all. Don't give him just 50%, okay. Give him 100%. Take it all. His delight was not in the blessing, but in the blesser. His joy was not in the provision, but in the provider. His satisfaction was not in the gift, but in the giver. And this is ultimate devotion. This is true, genuine affection for the king. This is the greatest act of service that we can render to the one who has showered upon us kindness beyond measure. One day, King Jesus will return. We will all stand before him, and he may ask questions. Not that he doesn't know the answer, but he wants to hear it from us. Where have you been? Why didn't you follow me? What have you been doing before my return? Now, how wonderful it would be if we can say to him from the bottom of our hearts, oh Lord, I've been longing for you to return. I've been yearning for you to take your rightful place as king over the earth. I've been praying, your kingdom come, your will be done. And then he says, yes, I know. You have true love, true devotion and affection towards me. I have heard you praying in secret. I have seen you doing good deeds in secret. I know that you give to the needy in secret. I have seen you serve with no fanfare, no spiritual showiness. And then he says to us, here then, my faithful servant, is your reward. And then in the spirit of Mephibosheth, we say to him, my Lord, give that reward to someone else. Give it to somebody else. It is reward enough for me just to see you return in peace and in your glory as king over all the earth. Let's pray. There's a psalmist who wrote in Psalm 73, whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides thee. Nothing on earth. Not possessions, not reputation, not healing, not sickness, not prosperity, not wealth. Nothing on earth that I desire besides thee. Dear Lord Jesus, we pray that you will give us this kind of heart, the heart of a Mephibosheth. We ask this in your name.
Thank you, Brother Larry, for the messages. Let us all take heed of the message and reflect upon it throughout the week, the posture of our heart. Shall we all stand to affirm our faith through the Nicene Creed? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, and by the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again and glorify. kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We will now collect the tithes and the offering. Prayer. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you.
Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Beloved, the scripture tells us that our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Prayer of humble access. We do not presume to come to your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs at your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ suffered and died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, with thanksgiving. Let us give thanks together in a prayer of thanksgiving. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of the Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. We shall now have the notices.
Notices, there will be a PCC meeting today at 1:30 p.m. I would like to urge all church members, keep PCC members in your prayers daily. Birthdays for the coming week, we have Cheryl Un, 19 August, and Captain Rui Meng, 22nd August. All right, let's commit them in prayers. Dear God, we bring before you Cheryl and Rui Meng. We pray for your guidance and wisdom over their lives. May they make wise decisions according to your will and guide them on the right path. May their choices be according to your divine plan. We bless them and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now the other notices, I would like to also to highlight our bowling competition. It's been a long time we have a bowling competition. So the list is up on the notice board. Do encourage. Your friends also can join. It doesn't have to be confined to only our church members. Bring your friends and join. It's the time of bonding and have fun together. All right? So we need a minimum of 30 people, right? Before we can have the competition. Not open to friends yet. Okay, so confined to church members, and it's only we can only have the bowling competition when we reach minimum 30 pax. Okay, so please do sign up early so that the organizers can plan. Okay, all the other notices are in the bulletin.
This coming Tuesday, a team of police from the Cheras headquarters, we're under Cheras area, will be coming here and to pay a friendly visit. I suppose they'll be visiting the other places of worship as well. So if you want to join in this small visit, you're most welcome to join in this Tuesday, 10:30 in the church. All right? Now shall we all rise for the closing sentence and we shall sing the benediction. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
go now in peace. Go now in peace.
God bless. Service is over.